Welcome everyone to this webinar hosted by Toradex. Today we are going to show you how the Verdin AM62 System supports and facilitates the development of modern and competitive products. My name is Simon Horvath. I'm a technical product manager working at Toradex. I'm focusing on customers' needs, their use cases, and markets. With my team, we are working on defining and delivering cutting-edge embedded products that provide simple, easy-to-use solutions and great value for our customers. Our guest for today's webinar is Brian Berner from Texas Instruments. Brian is a marketing manager working with global partners to deliver system-level solutions using TI's portfolio of ARM-based processors to help customers go to market faster. Welcome, Brian. I'm happy to have you here today.
Thanks, Simon. Happy to be here.
I would like to spend a couple of words on the agenda and highlight some of the interesting topics we plan to cover today. Why and level Verdin? So why did we decide to develop and launch such a system at Toradex? Give you insights into the reasons behind creating the Verdin AM62. Brian is going to present you TI processor overview and share some of the details of the AM62 SOC. Then we will look at why is the Verdin AM62 attractive. We will look at the overall value proposition, and we will see how does this new SOM support and facilitate the creation of modern and competitive products. Before we dive in, let me cover a couple of organizational points. At the end, we will do an interactive question-answer session, so you can type your questions in the chat window at any time. We will pick them up at the end, and we will try to answer all what we can. The webinar will be recorded and made available for on-demand viewing. Please use the chat window if you experience any issues during the webinar and you would like to let us know. With this, let's get started. First, I would like to give you a brief introduction to who we are and what we do at Toradex. We make embedded computing easy to use. We provide access to the latest technologies for your product development needs in a simple and easy to use form. We provide highly reliable ARM system of modules, SOMs, including hardware, software, and support. So basically in the form of a complete product package and experience. We strive to offer the lowest cost of ownership to you. What does that mean exactly? We'll cover that topic later on. We are proud of our industry-leading support, including a very active community and a developer website with over 800 articles, which are updated on a daily basis. As you can see, we have offices all around the world, providing local presence, local support, and warehouses so that we can serve your needs better. Our typical applications and top markets are industrial automation, healthcare, transportation and logistics, test and measurement, and also smart city. The typical volumes of our individual customers range from roughly a couple hundred pieces of SOMs to several tens of thousands of products per project. So that's really a broad range. We have a very heterogeneous customer base, and we love this and we are very proud of it. On the next slide, you have an overview of our complete SOM product portfolio, giving an idea about the broad selection we have here. We offer these to meet the needs of customers looking for industrial computing solutions. And if you look at the slide, you already see the three different families here, SOM families. We offer the Colibri, the Verdin, and the Apalis. On the next slide, we look at these three and focus on the key differentiators of them. Colibri is an entry-level to medium performance range, traditional SOM family. This is the first Toradex SOM family we ever had. The Verdin is as well an entry-level to medium performance offering, but in a more modern form. And Apalis is our medium to high performance solution for really demanding applications. As today's webinar is about the Verdin AM62, on the next slide, we look at some of the highlights of the Verdin family. The Verdin is a scalable, pin-compatible family of modules. based on a standard connector. That's an SODIMM DDR4 connector. Verdin offers modern high-speed interfaces, USB 3, Gigabit Ethernet, PCI Express, MIPI DSI for display, MIPI CSI for camera, Wi-Fi, and many more. One specific order of the Verdin SOMs is their wide input voltage range. This means that you can power these SOMs either from 3.3 or 5 volts, depending on the constraints of your carrier board design. And this allows for cost savings and easier integration. The Verdin SOMs, similarly to the other SOMs of Toradex, also come with support for industrial temperature range, meaning from minus 40 degrees Celsius to plus 85 degrees Celsius. Hardware-based security is a more and more interesting feature for customers. We hear a lot about these. We offer different peripherals like secure elements, trusted platform module assembly options, and we also heavily rely on the features provided by the system on chip themselves. From the design throughout the delivery process, we pay attention and put emphasis on vibration and shock resistance. This is an important design aspect for us, and we also test our SOMs and production intended carrier boards for that. One key value of us and our products is the long-term availability. Our SOMs are available typically for 10 plus years, so that means stability and predictability from an integration perspective. Here on the next slide, we have a poll for you.
I'll read the question, if anyone can hear me. Have you used a Toradex SOM before? Select all that apply. Yes, a Calibri SOM, Verdin SOM, Apollos, or not yet?
It's a roughly equal distribution. Some of you already use the Calibri SOM. Some of you already use the Verdin SOM. There are also Apollos users here. But it seems that the majority of people answering did not use a Toradex SOM yet. This is very interesting, and I'm very happy about having people here who are interested in Toradex products, but not our customers yet. Thank you for your feedback. It has been very interesting. With that, we shift our attention to an interesting and important question. Why an entry-level Verdin SOM? Why did we decide to develop and launch the AM62? So the first and the most important aspect is customer feedback. We are happy to hear from our customers, and some of the feedback which we got is compiled on this slide. Some of our customers have been looking for a SOM that is more affordable, while still being capable of running modern software stacks without paying a premium for performance if the extra performance is not needed. We've been asked to provide more scalability within the Verdin family. The Verdin family is, of course, the latest and newest family of Toradex. It's natural that we need to launch new SOMs and grow it. We have the feedback from our customers that pin compatibility and scalability between the different SOMs is important to them, also in terms of providing potential upgrade and optimization paths. Once you designed in a SOM, you need more performance, or you would like to optimize for cost, and you can upgrade, downgrade accordingly. Some of our customers are looking for supply chain diversification options, primarily driven by the challenges seen in the last couple of years in the supply chain directions. Having SOMs in the same family, leveraging different supply chains, could be an answer to that challenge. Some of our Calibri customers are looking for a viable migration or upgrade path from entry-level Calibri SOMs. And as a reminder, both families are low to medium performance range devices. Verdin is seen by some of our customers as a modern incarnation of Calibri. So there is also a need to be able to upgrade from some products using Calibri SOMs and upgrade them to be compatible with Verdin later on. On the next slide, you see basically the same picture just from a portfolio view. So this is before creating the Verdin AM62. On the left side, you see the performance range of SOM families. before the addition of the AM62, and on the right side chart, you see the price range. And if you look especially here, you compare the Colibri and the Verdin, on both charts, you see that the entry level of the Verdin is basically not there yet. The Colibri goes more close to the entry level and has been a better fit to some of the customers looking for such zones. On the next slide, you see the placement plan. What did we plan to do to improve this situation? So we planned to launch and develop a significantly lower price SOM than the existing Verdin SOMs, the Verdin AM62 Plus and the Verdin AM62 Mini. We knew that there are going to be some compromises to be made, but we wanted to make only acceptable compromises, and we wanted to incorporate the inputs and the feedback of our customers here. And of course, we wanted to create as much additional value as possible. The next topic is a very interesting one. It's system on chip selection. So we did a complex evaluation and the benchmarking of the available solutions. This is just a very simplified view here, highlighting a couple of aspects that have been important for us. A note here, it's very subjective. It's based on our perspective, which was also shaped and influenced by the inputs of our customers. So this is in no way an objective representation, but this is the system which led us to select TI's AM62 in the end. Some of the key aspects have been price, scalability. We refer here to the diversity of configuration options, the overall price and performance range covered, age of the technology stack. Mainline Linux support is an interesting one. It's because of our software strategy, which is then again driven by the needs of our customers. Longevity and additional differentiation are some of the factors which we looked at here. And as you all know, we ended up selecting TI's AM62. Some of the reasons are TI's strong industrial focus, the great recognition and reputation of the brand among embedded engineers, the robustness and flexibility of the supply chain, and in general, a great alignment of goals and values, supporting customers to go to market faster with high quality and reliability products. We are happy to have them on board. And with that, I hand over to Brian.
Great, thanks for the introduction, Simon. And I think we can just get right into the material here, since you gave such a good overview of why we're looking at the Verdin AM62. And so TI processors, as a high level discussion, right? We have a broad range of markets. Industrial and automotive are the focus, and then the product lines that I support, right? When I'm looking at third-party ecosystem products are the high-end MCU, mid-range MPU, and very high-end SoC. And obviously the investment vectors, I think Simon covered a couple of these, right? But the alignment between TI and Toradex on the software, particularly on the right-hand side, security, right? We're bundling safety and security here, but they're two completely different vectors. But security, obviously a big focus, and then networking, key in a lot of IoT applications today. So if you go to the next slide, we'll just hone in on this product. I was just going to say, Simon, this is a test of how well you can read my mind. So we've only been working together for 9 months or whatever. We're focusing here clearly on the industrial market, right? Even though Simon mentioned vibration and shock resistance, I would be hard pressed to find an automotive customer using a traditional catalog SOM, but we're very focused on broad industrial customer base, right? So the types of end equipments that you can use this product in are pretty wide ranging. Thinking back to the embedded world demo, right? Simon had coffee machines, pizza makers, some edge AI applications, right? All very suitable here. And we're really focused on the mid-range MPU, right? Even though we're talking about the low end of the Verdin family, we are still talking about a Linux processor, right? So we're very clearly out of the MCU range. And so the investment vectors or investment areas for TI are general purpose, and then adding in some level of specificity, right, where we have a competitive advantage. And so adding networking, that would be in a different family of device, right? So the AM64 is an Ethernet switch, TSN, PCIe, right, all the industrial comms. Adding DSP is a starting point to getting to the analytics, but if you don't have some key features, DSP is more like audio, writing your own algorithms, right, doing some interesting things there. But then you add the analytics, you get more into the vision processing and AI. So you have the ISP, video encode, decode. So that's one of the things that Simon and I have been talking about, looking on the high end, right, Apollos, analytics, there might be a good fit there. But here we are very clearly talking about general purpose. And so I think the next slide, we zoom in on that. So I'm not going to spend too much time reiterating these points, but on the software side, right, our standard distribution is Linux Yocto. The primary operating system that we offer today on TI.com is Android. I think all of our partners, especially Toradex, have some flavor of Debian, right? So you have an OS for development, and then Android is more of a deployment. And then when we look across the software ecosystem, right, even though Toradex has some strong offerings, the graphics typically needs some level of professional engagement on the software ecosystem. So Qt Group, Altia, Crank, and then kind of the entry point for a lot of people today is Flutter. And so on the right-hand side, you actually see a user interface or HMI for an EV charging station developed in Flutter with some custom assets. And that EV charging UI connects to the lower level software stack. So in this example, we're talking about application specific software partner for EV charging, and that would be the Pionix Everest platform. So yeah, I think outside of EV charging, right, we would always be looking at software partners with open source software stacks, things that can be reused effectively. And so Flutter and Pionix makes perfect sense together. I think medical and some other applications would have other needs. So yeah, where, you know, we've invested in AM62 and the reasons that Simon and his team picked the device, I think power efficiency, you know, I've talked about a lot, not necessarily critical in a line-powered application. Not a lot of SOM applications, in my experience, are battery-powered, but you can run the entire system at a lower voltage than you would be able to historically, simplifying the power tree, right? So just improving the operating points so you can run up to 1.4 gigahertz at 0.85 volts without doing any what we call dynamic voltage and frequency scaling. So DVFS not required. Advanced display features, which we'll get into a little bit, but a full 3D GPU and dual display. We're working our way clockwise around this slide. So there is an Edge AI SDK on top of the base processor SDK. So the device itself, even though it's general purpose, has MIPI CSI inputs, and it can also run the Edge AI SDK on the A53 cores. So again, another area where I think, you know, we can play around with, this is a cost optimized analytic solution, right? Where you can do some machine vision applications if they're optimized for the device. And then cost effective system level solution. Obviously you can look around the TI portfolio and see a lot of CAN transceivers, RS-232-45, right? A lot of system level requirements went into trying to figure out how to make the most cost-effective system. And so ADCs, a lot of applications, at least in our research, would be very specific when they look at what ADC to use. And so pulling that out of the device, right, where it's not as efficient from a cost perspective in this process node, then you can look across all of TI's ADC portfolio and kind of pick the right one for the application. Number of inputs, speed, and of course the type, right? A SAR ADC versus a Sigma Delta. So a lot of different system requirements went into making those decisions. And then, of course, security, the last one here, which we'll talk about. I'm sure Simon will talk about it in more detail. But we have the HSM and then secure boot through an M4, along with some inline ECC, security, crypto accelerators. And I think, yeah, we'll talk about kind of the flow at some point of how you go to production with a secure device, secure software, and burn your keys onto a Toradex SOM. And so because Simon highlighted this so effectively, I think it is key to talk about supply chain, right? Even though we're kind of coming out of one of the worst supply chain crises in recent history. The investments across TI, right now we're looking at the processor, right? So AM62 is on a 16 nanometer process node. And that is external, right? So we use an external foundry, TSMC. And so we're moving into that node with our new devices as they shift away in the consumer electronic space, typically to 5 nanometer. Obviously, we want to have as much of a dual source strategy as possible, de-risking our supply chain. And then we don't have any supply chain constraints in that TSMC 16 nanometer process node. Of course, we do have a standard lead time, but that's one of the benefits of the module vendors, right? Like Toradex, they will manage their inventory based on your feedback and probably aggregate some demand so that there's a lot less risk in your ability to find and procure parts when you need them most. And so when you look at analog and the stories that TI has been leading with, most of our analog is in a 45 nanometer process, and we've expanded our 300 millimeter wafer capacity significantly, right? So we have RFAB 2 just down the street in Richardson, Lehi, Utah, is starting to work on a new 300 millimeter wafer, primarily for analog, but that to some extent will benefit us here as well as we look at Ethernet PHYs and other things around the processor. Yeah, so just diving into the AM62 in a little bit more detail. I'm actually using the bullet points that Simon thought would be most interesting here. So obviously the architecture, right, ARMv8, 16 nanometer FinFET, single through quad A53 cores. He's showing it there. Yeah, I mean, it's hard to appreciate how small it is when I blow it up on the image there. The Cortex M4, right now, all the code for that is bare metal, but obviously we have a plan to have our free RTOS support and future real-time operating systems on the M4 as well. And DDR / LPDDR4, right, so the lower voltages, again, and then the hardware security module. And what TI is known for historically is what we call the programmable real-time unit. A lot of people refer to that today as flexible I/O. And so those flexible I/O can be used in a variety of ways. On the networking side, they're typically gigabit Ethernet PHYs. Here, they could be used as what we call general purpose media controller, but usually people think of that as like a parallel interface, right, to work with a kind of low-end lattice type FPGA. But you can use those flexible I/O in a variety of ways. And then, of course, the 3D GPU. So you can find the full block diagram. Obviously, the text is a little small here on TI.com and dig into some of the details there as well. Yeah, so looking at how we've progressed as a company from where we've had a lot of broad industrial success, right, with thousands of customers, AM335 is kind of our flagship entry to mid performance device. So AM335X, I believe the AM335-8 was used on BeagleBone Black, but that was a single A8 core, right? So even though you could theoretically do some high performance stuff running at 1 gigahertz, running Android on a BeagleBone Black might not have been the best user experience, right? An older version of memory, and then the GPU, right? So a single type of output, I think it was just RGB only, single display, 1080p. So across the board, we've increased the performance and migrated from the BeagleBone Black using AM335 to the new community development platform, Beagle Play, and that's using AM62. And so when you look at the form factor of those, they're a little bit different. And that is primarily because the BeagleBone Black architecture was similar to some other community boards that you might have run across in the past. But you can take Beagle capes and attach them to those headers there and expand the I/O and performance through that. So then you could theoretically, you know, have your whole system rapid prototyped on the Beagle cape. For the new device, you know, we're looking at not necessarily just new technologies, but new ecosystems that we can tap into, right? So if you're not ready to design a baseboard around Verdin, you could pick up a Beagle Play and test thousands of IOs, sensors, actuators with the SparkFun Quick ecosystem, the Seed Studio Grove ecosystem, and the Microbus clickboard. So I think the clickboards, as of the last count, had like 1,400 in their portfolio. Wide range, right? Sensor technologies, optical, temperature and humidity, but even getting into wireless, so cellular modems, GPS, DNSS. And then we have kind of bridging the gap between our processor family and our wireless connectivity. The Beagle Connect Freedom on the right-hand side gives you the ability to connect a broad array of sensor nodes and connect those from long range, low power, using our sub 1 gig and 2.4 gig device. So when you take all of that into consideration, right, the AM62 having that dual display where you can have an LVDS panel or any display panel, right, if it's converted to LVDS, HDMI out for your development environment, and then you have expanded peripherals, right? So when you're ready to start using those expanded peripherals, that's when you kind of migrate from ease of use development, very rapid prototyping to, okay, the Verdin has all of these IOs pulled out. I need CAN-FD, maybe two CAN-FDs. The MIPI CSI is used on both sides, but you might be looking at a higher performance camera. And then TSN capability, again, you could do the testing on both. But here we're showing gigabit Ethernet and single pair Ethernet. So you can start looking at that. And then the baseboard would be designed around your end application. And so just looking at the range of devices here, right, single, dual, quad A53s are shown in the first column. And then the 3D GPU is shown. And so the difference there is the AM623 versus the AM625. So the AM625 will have the GPU. And I think Simon mentioned briefly the low end of the Verdin family is leveraging the AM623, right? So when you look at the Pionix Flutter app, right, you're not using graphics extensively. You're not having a lot of moving images. And so maybe you don't need the GPU to hit those targets in your application. If you throw away the display completely, right, it's still a cost-optimized system for a headless application as well. And then you have those operating points on the A53 cores as well. So starting at 800 megahertz and going up to 1.4 gigahertz. Yes, I think the only other thing that was called out on some of the slides that we haven't talked about, right, Simon and Toradex are talking about longevity, industrial performance, right? All of our industrial grade devices are rated from minus 40 to 105 C, right? So our definition of industrial grade goes up on the high end to 105 C. So very robust, durable applications that require ruggedization could still deploy an AM62 device. And so why Toradex? I'm a little bit more personal here. Simon was talking about YTI, but more at the device level. I think looking at Toradex or the SOM offering as a hardware device, the ease of use is obviously a number one reason to look at this, right? So the PinMux tool that Toradex offers, before we even started working together, I had downloaded their PinMux tool and started seeing how could I get the right I/O out of the Verdin SOM quickly and start trying to design around it. So that, you know, taking our PinMux, understanding the flexibility, right, as Toradex has done, and then kind of shifting that over to what can you functionally use on a SOM is a critical piece of the design process. And then the scalability, right? So if you had used Verdin in the past, and I think it said 32% had used Verdin in the past, if you're looking at the higher end of performance right now, and then seeing, well, I don't really need some of these features, right? I think on the plus, right, you're looking at some of the things that we're investing in on analytics, right? ISP, what some people call a VPU, we do our analytics in the DSP. You can scale down to the AM62, and that's why when we talk about running the Edge AI SDK on the A53 cores, you have the opportunity to evaluate a range of product offerings to see if they meet your needs, right? And so I think looking at them and seeing the specs gives you a feel for it, but running those and doing the benchmarks, one of my favorite things from visiting the Toradex booth was looking at the benchmark as they were doing their live debugging, right? So they were testing the AM62 with the display output on, I don't know, like a 15-inch screen, but the entire time they were showing the FPS, right? So it was running at 30-plus FPS the entire time, even with some pretty heavy graphics. And so giving the opportunity to evaluate the device, even for camera attached, vision processing, machine learning, the scalability is key. And then the one that I highlight most frequently is the total solution, right? So the hardware plus the software. A lot of hardware vendors will get you all of those things in terms of scalability and pin mux. But when you're ready to start getting to production, ready to deploy software, there is a gap. And a lot of times that gap is filled by another third party, whether it's for graphics, which is still typical, you know, when you're migrating from, okay, this Flutter app is good, but I don't have enough time to finish it, you might go to Qt or Altia. But whenever you're looking at security, over-the-air updates, fleet management, a lot of times you'll be overwhelmed with options, and identifying kind of where the overlap is, selecting the right partner there can be challenging. And so the scaling from maybe 100 units or 1,000 units up to 50,000 units, you know, the Torizon platform will allow you to launch that fleet, do secure over the air updates, do fleet management, and decide what is the best option if you need to go to kind of a higher volume offering or add in some performance. Like, I think a lot of people use Amazon Grafana. I'm 90% sure there's a tie-in between the Torizon platform and an AWS Grafana front end. And then going back to just the vision processing one more time, right? Toradex had a partnership with Econ Systems at Embedded World to show the vision processing on the Verdin family. And so when you couple those two things together, it's really powerful, because when you start digging into ISP tuning, vision processing, you're typically handed off again to another third party without any understanding of how to implement those cameras and tune them to your needs. So that's a great way to get started with a production-ready camera solution. And then, of course, we are talking about industrial IoT a lot. Recently, even secure OTA comes back to this, but the Wi-Fi and Bluetooth on board is key when you're trying to just get things going and not have to worry about how do I design this and then qualify an additional piece on my my baseboard, which is a common methodology, right? So when SOM vendors try to optimize for size, the first thing to go is typically the Wi-Fi and Bluetooth module on board. And then, yeah, just looking at the system level solution, right? AM62 is optimized for both HMI and headless IoT gateway type of systems. The Verdin SOM takes advantage of that and optimizes cost for those headless systems as well. Back to you, Simon.
Thank you very much, Brian. Thank you for your kind words and also the interesting and important insights into TI's portfolio and what are you working on. Thank you again. With that, let's shift our attention to the Verdin AM62 SOM, an attractive entry point to the Verdin family. And I would like to start with an interesting question. Why is it attractive? And on the next couple of slides, we are going to do a deep dive into the reasons. And I want to refer back to the portfolio view, of which we already explained before, but here we are looking at after adding the Verdin AM62. So you see how nicely it fits into the portfolio together with the rest of the products there. What it means to you is just an additional step, an additional combination of price and performance that basically opens up a new area which has not been accessible in the Verdin family before. Referring back to the charts we've already seen, you see how the Verdin family, which is represented by the green bars here, is expanded towards the lower end in terms of performance and also price with the addition of the Verdin AM62. So an additional reason, why is it attractive? So from the beginning on, a key design aspect for us has been cost efficiency. And I can list a couple of topics which relate to that. So first of all, the PCB layer stack up. We challenged our internal teams to fit everything and route this on the lowest layer count possible. And they ended up with 6 layers for power and signals. In terms of PCB technology, we tried to avoid potential cost drivers there. For example, the team has not used any buried vias to do router routing. Component selection, bill of materials, we kept the same goals and selected components in line with the purpose of the product without compromising on high quality and reliability. We also took into consideration all the manufacturing and production testing aspects, which are oftentimes overlooked when it comes to considering the total cost of a product, and optimized all those aspects as well to keep the price low and make a more attractive product. Here is just a view of the PCB routing, and you see how tiny and how complex it is. It has been a great challenge for our team, and we are very happy that they managed to deliver on it. The next point is modern and high-speed connectivity. So the Verdin AM62 offers dual gigabit Ethernet, Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, CAN-FD, which is oftentimes used in transportation and logistics applications, MIPI DSI for displays, MIPI CSI for cameras, and many more. A very important aspect for us is software, and the Verdin AM62 is capable of running modern software stacks, and it is compatible with all of the operating systems which are listed here. First, I would like to talk about our embedded Linux BSP layers. So a BSP layer is basically software containing hardware-specific boot firmware, device drivers, and other routines that an embedded operating system can use and leverage to function. In our case, these BSP layers are based on Yocto, which is an embedded Linux build framework. Our embedded Linux reference images are pre-built, ready-to-try images meant to demonstrate our BSP layers. They are integrating these BSP layers and come in two different flavors, multimedia and minimal. So the multimedia image is with a graphical user interface, and the minimal is just a console image, providing a console. Torizon is our own industrial Linux platform, and of course the Verdin AM62 is going to be supported by Torizon as well. Other embedded Linux operating systems built by customers and partners, Android, QNX, and FreeRTOS are going to be available. On the next slide, I would like to spend a little bit of time on Torizon, our fast, reliable, secure industrial Linux platform. This platform is continuously maintained and free on the device. Torizon is also basing on our embedded Linux BSP layers and consists of the Torizon core operating system and the platform. The platform provides value-add features which help you reduce overhead and risk and increase the efficiency of managing embedded IoT devices. Some of the highlight features of the Torizon platform are over-the-air updates. So this allows you to update devices in the field without local physical access in a secure, predictable, and repeatable way. Secure offline updates are also meant to overcome the challenge of updating devices, but this time without network connectivity, but avoiding all the typical pitfalls of an update or an upgrade process, power loss, data corruption, etc. Device monitoring is another feature I would like to mention. It allows you to monitor devices remotely, detect issues before they become critical and cause downtime. You can monitor temperature, voltages, the statuses of peripherals, or any additional parameter which you consider to be important. Remote access is the last feature I would like to call out here. It allows for accessing devices and do troubleshooting remotely. And that's a feature Brian has been referring to before. With that, I move to the next slide, which is about our amazing out-of-the-box developer and user experience. I would like to start with product documentation. We have product briefs, hardware data sheets, the Pinel Designer application available to facilitate your designing process. For the same purpose, we have various hardware design guides, carrier boards and accessory reference designs, PCB layout guide, carrier board design guides for each family, taking into consideration the specifics of the families and helping you basically navigate through the challenges while designing your own carrier board. We also have product quick start guides, which help you get up and running in just a few minutes. These are available on our developer website. The Toradex Easy Installer is another interesting application. This is a default software our SOMs ship with. The Toradex Easy Installer is also based on our embedded Linux BSP layers and provides a simple graphical user interface for flashing different images onto SOMs, so facilitates, accelerates, and makes the provisioning process more efficient. The Toradex developer website with detailed technical articles and quick start guides is another important source of information which you can leverage. And then I would like to refer back to our community, which is consisting of Toradex users and developers worldwide, sharing challenges and solutions moderated by Toradex employees. So all of these together contribute to a very nice out-of-the-box developer and user experience. Of course, the Verdin AM62 is compliant to all of the well-known traditional Toradex values, future-proofness and scalability via pin compatibility with the Verdin AM68 and Mini and Plus SOMs, high quality reliability, something Toradex is very well known for. This is reflected in customer satisfaction service too, and it's a very important factor for us that contributes to having happy customers for the long term. Long-term availability, 10 plus years, we've already mentioned that before. So supporting and maintaining our SOMs, as long as the SOCs are available from the SOC vendor, hardware maintenance, including component changes, compliance updates, and software maintenance with regular software updates, bug fixes, and security enhancements. These are all part of the package. Best-in-class customer support, the Toradex community, which I already mentioned before, and we also have a worldwide network of field application engineers who are ready to help you and are available when you need them. On the next slide, I would like to talk a little bit about total cost of ownership. So what we mean is all of the different types of costs over the lifetime of the product. Developing and bringing the product to the market and maintaining it, each and every cost which arises during that process. Examples could be design and development costs for hardware, software, verification and validation costs, certification costs, maintenance costs, hardware, software, and of course the BOM cost, the bill of materials cost at the end. These are all costs you are going to face when you develop a product based on a SOM or based on a single board computer. There is no way around it. And what we are optimizing and minimizing at Toradex is this total cost. So not only the individual unit cost, but all the rest together. And I would like to give you a couple of examples on how do we do this and how do we try to keep this total cost low. So we are having a very transparent cost structure. We provide a very smooth development experience, enabled by all the tooling and all the pieces of hardware and software and documentation we already and services we already talked about before, high quality, reliability, all the free hardware and software maintenance, the efficient handling of potential issues and challenges if or when they arise, pre-certifications, reports, and partners for supporting your certification efforts. So we try to focus on each and every stage of the development and maintenance process and provide added value to make this total cost of ownership as low as possible. So the outcome based on all of this is the lowest total cost of ownership for you, a short time to market, allowing you to focus on where you plan to add value without surprises and unexpected blockages down the road, enabling you to get to the market in a short time and start generating revenue there. One of the base principles here at Toradex is that we are only successful if the products of our customers are successful. So all of the above listed things make the Verdin AM62 an ideal choice for high volume projects or cost conscious projects where cost and effort savings make a huge difference and impact in the end. With that, I would like to move to the features of the Verdin AM62. Brian already covered some of these aspects, so I will just point out a couple of them. We are offering single, dual, and quad-core configurations. An MCU core is also available for real-time control applications, real-time monitoring and control. In terms of RAM capacity, 512 megabytes, 1 gigabyte, 2 gigabytes are the options. As I said before, we have dual gigabit Ethernet, Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, and some other interfaces as well. Here we have the block diagram, and I would like to point out a couple of things here. It's a little bit small. I'm sorry for that. I hope we are still able to cover some of the interesting parts. I would like to show you the LPDDR4 RAM, which is up there. Here we have 16-bit width in case of the AM62. If you go through the block diagram, you will see lots of Texas Instruments components, the ADC here, and of course the PMIC and the system on chip itself, the Ethernet PHY. So this goes basically hand in hand with the statements I made before and also with Brian's comments. We are leveraging the industrial offerings of TI to build a reliable and cost-efficient SOM here. An additional feature I would like to show you is the parallel RGB to DSI display bridge here. That's an automotive Toshiba part. So the MIPI DSI is the primary display interface in the Verdin family, and we decided to optionally make that available via this converter here. We also have Wi-Fi Bluetooth on the SOM, and here I have a note. We plan to update this solution with the next design iteration of this product, the AM62. So the public samples very likely are going to feature a different solution here. Then moving to a broader overview of the interfaces. First, I would like to quickly cover the three interface categories in the Verdin specification. The first one is the always compatible interfaces. These are dedicated pins, are guaranteed to be present on every Verdin module and guaranteed to be functionally and electrically compatible between all of the Verdin SOMs. So the takeaway here, if you choose to use always compatible interfaces only, you will have fully scalable designs where you can just replace the SOMs from a hardware perspective without any limitations. The next category of interfaces is the reserved. These are also on dedicated pins, may or may not be present on certain Verdin SOMs, but if a reserved interface is present, then the pins will be used always the same pins. And if an interface is not present, the pins are still guaranteed to be electrically compatible. So you should still be able to replace, swap SOMs, switch from a Mini to an AM62 or the other way around. The worst case scenario is that you're losing some functionality, but you should not face any electrical incompatibilities. The last category is the module specific interfaces. Those are allocated to a range of pins, which are reserved for this purpose. We use these pins for making special features of certain SOCs available. If you decide to use any module-specific interfaces, then you need to know that scalability between the different SOMs may be limited, and also electrical compatibility in this case is not guaranteed. So this should always be considered and taken into account. With that, these are the interfaces of the Verdin AM62. The always compatible ones I'm not covering here because these are available in each and every Verdin SOM. In the reserved category, you see that Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, RGMII for a second Ethernet, ConnectD, BPDSI, CSI are available, but there are also some others which are not. And these are USB 3, HDMI, and PCI Express. As I said before, these are optional features of the Verdin family and typically available on higher-end offerings there, and they are not present on the AM62. In the module-specific class of interfaces, you find an additional CAN-FD and also a dual-channel LVDS interface. On this slide, I would like to give you an introduction into our configuration creation process. And let's start from assembly options there. Assembly options are specific to the PCB or the design of the system or module. So this is basically the full range of chips and features that theoretically could be assembled and supported. What happens after concluding the design, we are creating some so-called concept configurations. These are defined by Toradex early in the process, may change based on customer feedback, and they are not manufactured. So these are configurations which we define and tweak based on your feedback before transitioning them to off-the-shelf configurations. Off-the-shelf configurations are the so-called committed configurations that are pre-built to stock and available through our website. So these are the configurations which by default you can purchase and use. And there is another interesting category I would like to highlight here. We call them build to order or BTO configurations. These are custom configurations defined to meet the unique needs of individual customers. So if you look at the available assembly options, and if you see you need something that is not available in an off-the-shelf configuration, you always have an opportunity to get in touch with us and talk about your needs. And on the next slide, we are basically providing all of the assembly options that are available on the Verdin AM62. So the system on chip variant, where you can have single core, dual core, quad core, with GPU, without GPU, etc. RAM capacity, 0.5 gig, 1 gigabyte, 2 gigabytes, eMMC capacity, 4 gigabytes, 8 gigabytes or more, with or without Ethernet PHY, with or without Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, with or without the parallel RGB to MIPI DSI bridge, and the same, the list goes on for ADC, PCB temperature sensor. And another interesting and oftentimes leveraged configuration option or assembly option is the temperature range. We offer our SOMs in consumer, wide, and industrial temperature ranges. Here is basically a view of the currently defined draft configurations. These are also available on our main website. So feel free to check those out and give us feedback. Let us know about what do you need there. Just a couple of points I would like to highlight here. In this concept configuration set here, Wi-Fi Bluetooth is a feature which is appearing on the higher end. The MIPI DSI interface is present on most of the configurations, except for a couple of entry-level modules, which are always single core with a limited amount of memory there. So this is the idea. Have a look yourself, and please let us know what would you need. And with that, we arrive to a new poll. And here the question is, what other features do you need for the Verdin AM62 SOM? A PCB temperature sensor, a trusted platform module, TPM, Thread/Matter radio for mesh networking or home automation, secure element, or none of the above. So we will wait a couple of seconds. Please give us feedback, and then we will have a look at the results. So we have the results here. PCB temperature sensor, 38%. Trusted platform module appears reasonably high in the list, as well as a secure element. This just shows an increasing interest for security related features. And these are also inputs which we are going to consider when deciding about the next iteration of the hardware, which again should happen before the public sample release. Thank you very much for your feedback there. On the next slide, we look at the ecosystem. We are having different evaluation carrier boards, Verdin development board for hardware evaluation, Dahlia and Yavia for software development. We are about to launch our first production carrier board within the Verdin family. It's called Mellow. It's a small form factor board with lots of features included. You see a picture here on the slide. Our intention is to launch this together with the Verdin AM62 later during this year. We have a broad range of accessories available, carrier board accessory kit, heat sinks, Wi-Fi, Bluetooth antennas, accessories, displays, converters, and the list goes on. We also have a broad partner network. So if you realize that you need a different carrier board from the ones we are offering, or you need product design services, or would you like to get support with software development or customization, feel free to also get in touch with us, because there are great chances that we will be able to put you in contact with one of our partners who would be able to help you there. This is our launch plan for the Verdin AM62. In terms of hardware, we are starting a limited prototype early access. Right now, this is a closed program for partners and customers that have a lot of experience with embedded hardware and software. There are some drawbacks, limited documentation in this very early phase, limited support as well. Product issues are still to be expected. So this is really for early adopters who like living on the bleeding edge, testing stuff and giving us feedback. If you are interested, please contact us. The public sample availability is starting in July this year. This is open access for all customers, all partners, with complete documentation, full support, and of course availability in our webshop. If you have any questions, please let us know. In terms of software, we are targeting the same July 2023 a date here with our embedded Linux BSP layers, reference images, Toradex Easy Installer, and Torizon as well. If you have any needs in the direction of Android or QNX, please contact us and let us know. I would like to talk a little bit about pricing. The Verdin AM62 is starting at a very impressive 33 euros or 35 US dollars, depending on configuration and volume. Based on the early feedback, our customers find the features and the price a very good combination here, basically enabling the realization of cost-conscious or high-volume projects to which the Verdin family may not have been the best fit before. This combination also creates an interesting and viable upgrade path for products using Calibrisons today. Based on all of this, we believe that the Verdin AM62 is going to be a very successful product and one of the high runners for the years to come. One of the very important takeaways for me while we are reaching the end of the presentation is please contact us for early access, for pricing information, or any additional question or need you may have through our website, www.toradex.com. Here we have a screenshot. Basically, whenever you visit our website, in the bottom right corner, you will find a contact form. And that is a way for getting in touch with us at any time. So with that, we are at the end of the presentation. And we are reaching the Q&A session here. We received a lot of questions in the meantime, so I will just look at those and try to answer what we can. We are almost out of the time, but I think it's really worth spending a couple of minutes here. If we cannot answer a question, we will get back to you offline. The first one, what is the camera interface available? So the camera interface available for the Verdin AM62 is MIPI CSI, MIPI CSI 2 to be more accurate. GPU is Mali or something else. Brian, you want to take that?
Yeah, just to add one point to the MIPI CSI 2. So it is a full four lanes of MIPI CSI 2, and the internal PHY is actually rated up to 2.5 gigabits per second. So it's higher than the traditional spec. So if you wanted to do a slightly higher performance camera, you can with that. But you would need to have an ISP located on the camera module. The GPU, I think it was actually in my slides, but let me pull up the additional details on that. So it is an Imagination GPU. Axe is the family. I don't have the number off the top of my head.
But I think, Brian, you provided quite some feedback there. So on the rest of the details, we can probably just get back offline.
Yeah, so it's the Axe 1-16M, and it runs at 500 megahertz. And it is OpenGL ES 3.1 Vulkan.
Thank you, Brian. The next question is, before selecting the SOM, is it possible to profile first? So that is exactly the reason why we also are having a lot of evaluation products in our web shop. This ranges from carrier boards through TOMs, which of course you can purchase in single quantities as well, and really broad range of accessories, converters, cameras, displays, accessory kits. So this is all targeting the evaluation experience in a typical customer journey. Customers would purchase of devices first and do their evaluation before deciding on starting development and going into production. Next one, any idea on power consumption, please? The power consumption, we have some early numbers on that on the Toradex side, and based on that, we expect that the maximum power consumption of the SOM to be in the 3.54 watts range, but there are still a lot of tests ongoing, so we will be able to comment on that. And by the way, on our developer website, searching for a specific SOM, you are able to find very detailed power consumption information with 15-20 different use cases. So feel free to have a look there. This is something we are going to have in a more accurate form in the future.
Now I have a follow-up question. So the maximum power consumption, that does that include outputs like the USB 2, or is that just, okay, it does?
Yeah, in some typical use cases. But basically what happens, we are loading all IPs contained within the SOC with some sort of tooling as much as we can, and we are stressing the device also from various other directions. But the use cases are provided on the developer website, and it's really worth having a look there.
Yeah, so I think historically our target for like a sleep state is always 5 to 10 milliwatts. And the active state for the processor is 1 to 2 watts.
Yeah. And then, of course, there are some other peripherals there. We really look at the total consumption of the SOM in a worst case scenario in these cases with these measurements. What is the most affordable development board to get familiar with the AM62? I think that really depends on your needs. So the Verdin development board is the one which we use to recommend if you are to do hardware evaluation. You need lots of jumper wires, connecting sensors, and changing configuration of the board. At a later stage of software development, we typically recommend the Dahlia or the Yavia, which are more compact boards focusing on the software development process. I'm somewhat familiar with the pinout designer. Does it support the new SOM? Yes, so latest release of the pinout designer, which is also available on our developer website, has support for currently defined Verdin AM62 concept configurations. So I encourage you to have a look, download it, try it out, and see how the AM62 works for your particular design idea. I think we can have a look at the last question and then We will need to conclude, but we will get back to all of you who may have asked questions and didn't get feedback yet. This may be a question to you, Brian. Speaking about Beagle Play, how many microbus boards can be attached at the same time? Only one or stacking several microbus boards are still possible?
Good question. Yeah, so the microbus clickboard interface is just one at a time for development, but they have something called the shuttle board. And so the shuttle board takes one, and then you can daisy chain up to, I believe, four. I don't know if you can daisy chain all of the interfaces, but you can certainly use some of those interfaces independently. So Quick is actually designed to be I2C rapid prototyping, Quick and Grove. And so you can daisy chain multiple devices directly. The shuttle for the microbus clickboard, I'm not sure if you have to split them. So I2C and SPI and you are all being separate, but I can look into that. The shuttle also gives you the ability to just have a little bit more range distance wise. I think it's like 6 inches long.
Thank you, Brian. And I will take a last one. Is it possible to get access to the PRUSS for development on the carrier board? So I can answer this from a Toradex perspective. When designing the AM62, we tried to come up with a pin multiplexing. Also makes it possible to leverage the PRU. The PRU is typically not something which we've been using on the Toradex side, obviously, because this is the first time we are having a SOM based on a TI system on chip. The IP itself is optionally available on the SOC. So if you have any related needs, please let us know, and please really have a look at the configuration and give us your feedback. And we are potentially able to support you there.
Do you have any questions? Yeah, I think the PRU, a lot of that Flex.io goes back to what is the use case on those specific pins, right? And so a lot of those pins are muxed with other functions like audio. So we use MIC-ASP, which is I2S compatible. You have some additional SPI, I2C, UARTs, CANs that are also pulled out on those PRU pins. So if you have a very specific need, I think that's a case where Simon would send that request down to Sao Paulo, and they would look into it. And one of the benefits of the Beagle system and kind of having this three-way interoperability testing is that they can leverage anything the community's done on the PRU. Historically, on the AM335 with BeagleBone Black, it was used for a lot of digital signage applications. So high-functioning display, but not necessarily high-resolution displays. And so taking that knowledge base from the community and transferring it to the Toradex software development team is definitely one of our goals. But we would, at least in the early stages, have to know what is the use case.
Thank you very much, Brian, for your feedback on that one. With that, let's conclude here. Thank you very much for your interest. I'm very happy and excited to have this webinar with you. I hope to see you soon with your questions on the AM62, and I wish you a great day, a great afternoon, depending on where you are. Have a nice day. Take care. Bye, everyone.
Thanks, Simon. Thanks, everyone, for joining.